Hello, welcome back to the channel. I'm glad you're here. Thanks for tuning in. I'm Jimmy. We're making it work. We're gonna spend a day in the shop. If you're new here, you might be amazed, baffled, and confused at the kind of stuff that we do. But find a way to make it work. Could be classic Cadillac DeVilles, could be 65 Chevy trucks, could be my own 62 C10 project truck I have over here, as well as Volkswagen engines that I work on perpetuity, S10s. Might never get them done. I just want to create content for you guys, so I try not to finish them so that we can stay busy. That's not really true at all. I do joke around a little bit, try to have some fun, and I try to make sure I can teach you guys something as well as learning something myself. Being a master mechanic doesn't mean you know everything. It means you have a tendency to figure things out with a little bit more training and certifications and stuff. But a lot of that stuff, I mean, I know plenty of good mechanics that aren't ASC certified at all. And I know plenty of ASC certified mechanics that aren't very good at all either. So everything's got gray areas, right? Anyway, we don't hear for any of that stuff. I'm bloviating while I contemplate my existence and see how much I have to work on that Volkswagen again. I think I'm supposed to start on a 65 C10 today, but we don't have all the parts. So they got me blocked off for the whole day on it because it needs about 18 hours worth of work. But we'll see what happens with that. We got quite a few vehicles that have been here a while. The BMW was towed in 2 days ago. It's still out here in the grass. Maybe that'll be in the clips that I'm gonna put in right here so you can see what's gonna happen in this video. 2022 Honda Civic. Oh man, it can't be a broken Toyota. We keep them in stock. We sell tons of them. All right, we got a partly cloudy sky. It's supposed to be about 78, 79 degrees today. It's about 65 right now. Beautiful morning. We'll see what happens with the weather. I think it's gonna be cloudy for the next week or so looking at the weather, but not a ton of rain. I don't know how it is by you. Hope it's not too chilly. We're getting ready for spring, so I'm sure a lot of you are looking forward to that. We get spring most of the year. spring and summer, those are our two seasons. Let's finish getting the shop open up and get started. Stay tuned. All right, guys, first thing this morning, I want to look at this battery and see if we got at least 12.6, 12.5 volts. DC, negatory, come on now, suppository, ta-da, all right. So that battery recovered okay. I would suspect, as I've told them up front, the battery's probably not gonna be long for the world. Not very impressed with these Duralast Golds, tell you the truth. So we'll see. We'll advise the customer if you have any more battery problems. They do need to put a trickle charger like a battery tender, or the Topton makes a similar one. I actually prefer the battery tender because it turns itself on and maintains the battery without pushing any buttons. So if you store your car for a month or two at a time, you put that trickle charger, it maintains your battery and it'd be perfect when you go to start it again. If they have problems with it, we're probably going to have to put an Interstate in it, which even Interstate's not the best battery in the world. From my experience, the AC Delco batteries are good. Some people hate those. Everyone's got opinions, but there was a time when Interstate set the bar a long time ago. And then they started putting profits first and their product went downhill like most of them have. Oh, that rack, Joe, see the boxes of racks up there? Joe put 5 racks in that Ford Explorer. The 5th one has a problem where it doesn't have power steering for the first 5 seconds when you start it. And if the rack from Ford, national back order. You guys know the deal. So I kind of feel for that for him too. He's been having a rough February. Let's go look. I'll show you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All for the same vehicle. It's got to be costing a rebuilder a fortune. That one came from O'Reilly. I don't know if they all did. I don't even know AutoZone, so I don't even know what brand they are. Master Pro. 5 of them, and I still got a problem. So, gonna have to go to the Ford one, I would think, but it's gotta come off back order first. What do you guys think about parts nowadays? You guys seeing similar problems? Where you gotta do 4 or 5 aftermarket reman parts? Because we're seeing way more of it than I've ever experienced. This thing's done, I'm gonna button it up, pull it out. And I'm gonna pull the S10 out. It's the end of the month today, so you guys know I film my videos a week in advance. I edit them during the weekend and film them during the week, right? So I'm filming this on the last day of February. So we gotta try to get some of these cars delivered because customers want them anyway, whether it's the end of the month or not, right? Man, I'm just not a fan of that new Honda front end. 2022 Honda Civic. Customer hears a noise underneath. gets worse at 65 miles an hour. And since there's nowhere around here I can go 65 miles an hour, we're gonna take a look around without going 65. This thing is a 2022 Honda Civic. 13,091 miles, so it should be under warranty, but yet here we are. We got auto air, but we're on low. And it's not even hot out yet. But anyway, I'm gonna love rating it too. Smoker's car, 13,000 miles and a year and a half old. And she's a mess, so. Cigarette ashes everywhere. Poor thing. Poor little car. Let's get a lift underneath and see. He said he heard a loud snap and now there's a noise on the road, so. But it's a brand new car, I don't understand. All we can do is take a look and see if we can spot something for him. And I think it's a half hour labor to take a look. Let's stop talking about and do it. Look, got a beautiful oak tree in the yard. Okay, enough of that. Hmm. 13,000 miles on the tires are already not doing too great. Looks like they're being run slightly underinflated. Maybe we'll check the tire pressure for them. Oh, it is a problem. That's gonna make a wicked fluttering noise when you go in 65 or to 100 miles per hour. What the heck happened there? You heard a loud snap. I'm guessing that's what it was. Something to do with this hitting something in the road. And it looks like it damaged this here. And it was dragging for a while and he kept driving and it finally broke off. But now it just flutters in the wind because there is turbulence under a car. So I don't see anything else. Nope, that's... That should be okay. It starts all the way up here. Man, that is a long piece of plastic. They're trying to, there's a lot of damage under here. They're trying to get gas mileage. That's, I believe this is to smooth it out. And look, maybe this has already been replaced or is that a factory? Yeah, that's a replacement part, I think. That's funny. I don't know, he's autocrossing or jumping railroad tracks or something. I don't know. It looks like it's been bottomed out. It doesn't look like it's been lowered. Maybe it has. It's hard to tell. It is a Honda Civic, so these cars tend to go through hell. They're great cars, but they're also well-loved by people who like to do things to them. They can't leave them alone. How do you curb the inside of a wheel? All right, enough of that. I'll tell them what I found, and this panel's probably like $400 from Honda or something. I don't know. It might be $18. We'll find out. And the muffler, that's not going to cause any noises, but it is damaged, so we'll have to let them know. And same thing with some of these studs are broken out of the floor. If I bend it back, it's going to just pop off, so we don't want to mess with that. Still attached up front. You can't I could put a bigger washer on that, but I can't do anything really for this. You don't want to run screws up through this stuff, I don't think. But oh, there's a bolt missing out of there. All right, let me see what they want to do. I might end up just kind of patching it up for now. We'll see what that piece costs. He's got rash on that wheel. A little bit on that one. Just a little skosh. He's got, this one's really bad. Look at that poor thing. Oh my goodness gracious, this is a poor car. I'm sorry, Honda. Hopefully we'll get to take care of you. And then you're going to go back to your owner, unfortunately. But we'll do what we can in the meantime. And I will come back to this car. And there he goes. He was in the waiting room saying, I need a rental car out here right now. I'm not paying for a damn thing. And we showed him the damage and let him know it wouldn't be covered by anyone's warranty. He said, oh, I'm out of here. So there he goes. Have a good day. Poor little car. Oh, man, it can't be a broken Toyota. Don't even tell me. Actually, it's not. We're just doing some maintenance on her. 2008. Not sure what happened there, but that's all right. That's all right. Don't worry about it. We're going to do a tune-up, a belt, front brakes, and rotors. Oh, man, that thing needs motor mounts. My goodness gracious. 209,530 loving miles. Tire light blinking, maintenance required, check engine light on. She brought spark plugs for us to put in, which we're going to take care of that. That's quick and easy. I'm going to see what the code is real quick because we got about, I don't know, it's like 3 or 4 hours altogether for the brakes and the belt and the spark plugs and oil change. So I can spend a few minutes with my scan tool, see what kind of codes we might have. Oh, And then I know it's got TPMS codes, blinking TPMS light. Man, this thing runs rough. That front motor mount tends to collapse, makes the engine feel like it's sitting on the dashboard. You hear that noise? You can feel it exactly the way it sounds. So, let's look at that. It works even without the plastic panel. So that would drive me nuts. What do you guys think? You go to salvage, you get that panel for about 15 bucks. Just so that's not like that would I wouldn't be able to sleep, honestly. I'm not even joking. That's my problem, not yours. She plays baseball. That's good. Play a little ball every now and then. Just don't be careful. Don't come at me with one of those. Alright, let's be quiet and get to work to try to make some money this week. I'm trying to get over the 10-hour mark. No, I'm actually doing okay. It's not that bad. Just kidding. This is the mount that goes bad. See how it's sitting down here? Supposed to be a little gap on that, and it's obviously doing what we call sagging. Yeah, that's what we call it in the business. Take a look at the air filter and stuff like that. It needs wipers. They're pretty sacked out, especially the passenger side one. Who cares if your passenger can see, though? But still, I would do them in a pair. What do you think? What do you think about that air filter, man? Be an upselling fool. Woo! I'm gonna say that's a good idea. The problem is with these filters, when they're not even visibly dirty, they're already restricted because pollen and things clog the pores. Of course, you'll see a tint of a color on it, but once they're visibly dirty, they're bad. They need to be changed. It can affect your gas mileage a tiny bit. I mean, the car will tolerate a lot of abuse. So some people don't do it. You just blow them out with air and put it back. That's all. This cover's held on with some tens. We'll get, hey, easy, man. I finally got a car to film over here. Keep it down. I'm gonna get this cover off of there. Four tens on the coils. And this should be a piece of cake. We got some sweet NGK spark plugs, platinum alloy spark plugs. Now,
Jimmy, is it what you put the lock cylinder in?
No, it's a push button start.
It's a push start.
Locks the steering wheel. Column lock module.
It's a column steering column lock module.
Man, I don't like the look of that. It's not supposed to be like that. I'm going to try to pull these out without unplugging the coil connector because the coil connectors break. Toyota's, the plastic gets brittle. Like a lot of cars. I don't like putting stuff on the windshield wiper cowl, but this has a nice little lip on it. So if we're careful, we'll be all right. Got a little oil leak from the valve cover. See that all too often. Goodness gracious. It does not want to allow it to come up. So we'll take some more bolts out. There's probably another one in here somewhere if I can get it directly.
So you have it.
There you go. Now it comes out. Now we're good. Spark plug socket. We don't even have the old spark plugs out yet. I don't want to show you the new ones because I'm so excited about it. These things are beautiful. Not as beautiful as that one. I forget what it was. That car I put them in a week or two ago. It looked like jewelry. That's probably not supposed to be like that. I don't recommend trying that if you're not an expert. Oh, that wasn't tight. That's leaking combustion. That's what that is. That little trashy look that's got. I wouldn't be surprised if it's got a cylinder 3 misfire as part of the check engine light deal. Time for some new ones. Of course, I'm going to hit them with the old ratchet and make sure they're tightened properly. Make sure none of my electrodes are bent, but nice and straight. Spark plugs are correct for the application. They're already gapped. If you guys have been watching my videos a while, you know, you're not supposed to gap platinum tipped and iridium tipped spark plugs, right? recommended a valve cover gasket and changing the rubber insulators, but I think we're about tapped out, so I'm gonna rock it. You can go all out, put this on too. You can prep for the oil change part. Ah, gravity check my impact. Good thing that thing's durable. All right, I got my tensioner loose, and I had to slip this off of the old bomba de agua, as we like to say in Kissimmee. Belt's pretty easy on this, luckily. So I'm gonna go ahead and knock that out before I lift it up for the oil change part. The belt goes to the water pump between the alternator and compressor, and up to the tensioner between the power steering and crankshaft. Should be simple enough, even for my little tiny brain. Let's see if we can get this down there without having to do some of it from the bottom and some of it from the top. Uh-oh, I don't want to flip the belt around. That'll make it confusing. All right, that's not too bad. Come on now. Get on there, will you? Geez, Louise. The tensioner's a little odd, too. This might need a tensioner. I barely was able to get the belt on by slipping it over one of the smooth pulleys last. But it feels like there's good tension. We definitely have to make a note of that when we first start it up after all the work's done. Uh-oh. This has got locks so nobody steals the bald tires and wheels. Found it. This oil filter seems kind of small, but they've been doing it for decades, and it's okay. It's probably more critical that you don't skip oil changes, but let's get this drip pan under here. Of course, you know, we're using the Knipex Toyota Matrix oil filter tool. I'm gonna put the Proformer on there. 21394 MP is the part number. It stands for maximum petroleum. I don't know, something like that. You guys probably know not to use tools to put oil filters on, unless it's a canister that you need a socket for. But even then, you don't put them tight, because it makes me sad for no other reason. 14. Oh, that could be a little tighter than that. There's a sweet spot, is what I'm saying, like a Goldilocks kind of thing. Not too tight, not too loose, just right. Uh-oh. It's like I intentionally cupped the oil as it came out, just to add to the dramatic effect for the content. I'll go to any length for you guys. Oil's not that bad. Pretty clean, so that's good. She's taking care of it. I had someone tell me again, I've never changed a drain plug on a car in 30 years. I've been a professional mechanic, and I've never had one leak. But I'm going to put a new one on anyway, because what do I know? Look at that sweet, unnecessary drain plug gasket. Brand new. This oil is pretty nice, so if it was, the nastier it is, the longer I let them drip. But this oil is pretty good, so we're down to a trickle. We're good. Something happens when you're flapping your gum, working a camera, and doing a repair. Your dexterity goes out the window, I suppose. Something happened, I can't explain. I'm gonna wash off my area. A little bit of brake clean. It's free anyway, use it up. Now this thing does have some oil leaks. I'm not sure why she wanted a belt. The belt didn't look that bad to me, but it's not my call. The spark plugs definitely needed. It takes about 4.4 quarts of dinosaur blood in a 530 variety. So that's what we're gonna do. Of course, we're gonna check it on the dipstick, because paperwork's usually right, but not always. The dipstick can even be wrong too sometimes. I've seen people with the wrong dipstick in their car. So that's possible. You got a lot of things to consider in this business. I'm calling that good. Just a teeny bit over full. Let's do it again just to be sure. Nice. That little tiny filter is going to take that little bit up. We're butter. I'm going to put a sticker on the windshield, of course. And then I got to check to see if we're doing the air filter and the wipe the blade.
One thing I noticed, the battery hold down is not really a battery hold down, it's more of a battery suggestion. So we're gonna go ahead and try to make it into a hold down with some of the necessary hardware to do the job. It seems like the rod in the back is the only hole back there is a little far away. Well, the good news is at least the battery won't be completely flopping around when we're done, that's all. That's all I'm shooting for. Some form of a hold down. It's got a limitless tank on it, I think. You guys, if you haven't been watching my videos a while, a little thing that I try to do is put the nice side of the wheel facing away. In case you're spraying brake clean, you make spots. If someone's got nice wheels especially, making spots on their wheels makes for an unhappy customer. We got pads and rotors. Let's do it. I'm going to say that's a 14 on there. Give the old right angle impact some work. It's been feeling lonely in the box. So we'll have them come out to play. See, these are lubricated and there's barely any rust. That little tiny bit of dirt you see there, nothing to be concerned about. Pads come off the slides. I don't have to get a hammer and a punch. So the pads are definitely low. This pad's like 4 millimeters, so it's right on the edge. So good, I feel a little better. I had to go find my caliper piston depressing tool. I wasn't sure if I still had one, it's been so long. But it was there under some fender covers on my car. So, one disaster averted. I just use the pad because this tool sometimes will go right inside the piston. That's not productive. Give it a second, I don't force it back real quick. Back in the day, we used to open the bleeder. But I think the theory a lot of people are going by now is if you've been maintaining your brake fluid, it's no big deal. If you haven't been maintaining your brake fluid, shame on you. 17, I believe, holds this bracket on. And we gotta dress these pins, clean some things up, make it look real nice. Maybe even use a Scotch lock pad just for entertainment purposes. See what the old girl's got for this one. Oh yeah, it's a brute. Slides are in good shape. We're still gonna grease them anyway. Don't need tons of grease. This one's a little nasty. I'm gonna wipe this one down. It's a judgment call. You know, some people have a routine and they just do the same exact procedure every time, no matter what. I like to make a judgment call. The factory grease is gonna probably be the best grease that's ever on there. But if it gets gummy and gooey, then I'll wipe it off. This orange stuff's pretty good. Some people were saying, I guess it's the purple one, they said, doesn't work on the slide pins and gels up. I think it was Mike saying that, the master tech, master flat rate master, that guy. I haven't had that problem, but I'm sure it's a problem. I just haven't seen it, maybe. This is to go under the hardware. Because I don't want it to rust there either. They don't have the pads riding directly on the bracket for two reasons. The added components help with noise reduction, and plus it's a wearing item you can replace. Instead of putting a whole knuckle, a whole bracket on. You might notice there's not a lot of grease going on there either. The measurement, like I said, is enough, that's all. I bet you that thing looks nasty on camera, don't it? It's not, I mean, it's not perfect, but it's nowhere near as bad as it looks. So we'll clean it up, get us a nice, smooth, flat surface, make sure there's no bumps or chunks or, you know, your biggest concern or something like this is if the piece of rust on this side and there's none on the others, then it's gonna cause the rotor to be warped, right? So if all of this is flat and you don't feel bumps or lumps or anything really silly like this, it looks like a bump, it's not. What's important is that it's flat. I mean, you can shoot for pretty if you want, but on flat rate, you want to do a thorough job, not have a comeback, and be done with it. Now, if I got 200,000 views per video, and I made in a day what I make in a month at work, I made in a day on YouTube, then of course, I probably would do a little overkill on it. Look at that thing. It is gorgeous. It's gonna be a shame to run it on this car. Yeah.
You need any ammo?
No, I got plenty. Got to rock a little squealer, took it up the old pad, put it on these. It didn't come with them, so, and I always put it on the inside pad. And that's the one you can't see as easily. These have a little ledge. If you have this turned the wrong way, it'll hit that and it won't really be tight. And the bolts are long enough to reach too. So you gotta be sure you got it at the right angle. It helps you, helps keep it from spinning. But it can make you put it together wrong if you're not paying attention to it. This side's gonna go quite a bit faster. This is even heavier. These always have one odd corner. So make sure you put it the right way, that's all. This goes this way. You can read the print, I suppose. Down in the back. All right, you heard just about enough out of you. I reset the maintenance reminder. You hold the trip meter button in and then turn the key on and you'll get 5 dashes and they'll start blinking. Go to 4 dashes, 3, 2, 1, and then go off and show zeros. So you know the maintenance reminder was reset. I'm gonna put a sticker in it too, even though it doesn't have one from before, but I'm gonna put one in it. Oh wait, what's this? Aha, that's an unusual place for that. It was due at 2039, so it's only 6,000 miles over, 5,500 miles over, no big deal. Oh, we got updates, I'm gonna do them first. We'll come back, see what kind of codes we got, send a report. And this car will basically be done, from what I understand. We're not doing the wipers or any of the other stuff, the motor mount or anything, but it ought to run good. Matter of fact, I can fire it up right now, let's try it. Minus the vibration, it runs pretty good. Of course, it ran good coming in. Just had original spark plugs with 209K. That's a lot. Software's done. Auto scan. You know we're looking for a 7 right here, right? Oh my gracious goodness, that's a lot of codes. So that's a lot of codes. 26, 34, 37 codes. Let's go in the ECM here, see what codes are. They are. Readfall code. Cylinder 2 misfire, cylinder 1 misfire, cylinder system lean, multiple misfires, 3 and 4 misfires. Torque converter stuck off, lean, 974 current code. What is that? Oh, there's like a little, oh, there it is. Shift solenoid A, that's transmission related. All right, I gotta send a report first, my bad. I didn't do that yet, I skipped a part. I'll go ahead and send this up. Clear the codes, let them know that the light's gonna come back on. We didn't fix anything, we just turned the light off. And this car's done, 209,530. It's another good thing about the reports, you have the mileage recorded, all that stuff, so. And I aired the tires up, you guys, I don't know if I filmed that part or not. The tires weren't really low, but I aired them up anyway because their TPMS system doesn't work. It's kind of like that Volkswagen I put the engine in. It had 14 or 15 PSI in all the tires. I aired all them up while I was at it. We're going to do a, I've done diagnosing 9 ways to Sunday as far as voltage goes, powers, grounds, to that module. All my fuses and relays. I've tried switching relays out. I jumpered power to the fuse panel to force the scan tool to talk to all the modules. That way I can get all the codes from all the modules. And they're all real mad at the steering lock module. It all cleared out but 5 codes, and all 5 have to do with security and get the steering lock module. Anyway, let's see what happens. It's $200 guess. But at this point I've got 31 hours in the 17-hour job. So it's something we're gonna do, and we'll see how it goes. I'll either look silly, we spent more money, or it'll be fixed and it'll be like a lucky guess. So nature of the beast. Carrying on. Look at this thing. Isn't that something? That is something else. Volkswagen's like, oh yeah. We keep them in stock. We sell tons of them. So I'm hoping this is the problem. There's nothing else I can find on it. So this is what we're gonna do. I gotta turn some screws. There's some screws in here that are, they break off. These are breakaway screws. When it gets to the right torque, they snap off so you can't get them on and off. So the problem's gonna be getting them off. And I think we can do that. If you can, like other cars, chisel and a hammer, and it comes off of there. That's what we're gonna try. Broke this one loose. I'm wondering if I'm gonna have to take all this other stuff off. I'm trying to be sneaky and leave the turn signal, multifunction switch, whatever you want to call it, on, but this thing might be trapped inside it. We'll see. I know Hans and Franz, they like to be a little tricky, so, and they're probably way smarter than I am. Let's see here. I gotta take this off, take this off. I don't wanna break anything, but it definitely feels like it's trapped in here somehow. So looking at the new one, this little slot here, I think that's how they're trapping it in there. But other than that, it looks like it should fit out. If I can get that thing out of the slot, I'm thinking. You Volkswagen guys now are watching this laugh and going, hey Lord, what are you doing, buddy? But I'm doing what I gotta do. That's all I can do. Trying to make this thing work. See if we can find what else is holding it. Alright, Rob got the old one out for me while I was at lunch. He basically had to pop this plastic You had to pop this plastic over these little springer doodles. So once you pull it down, you can pop the plastic to the side. I didn't want to force it, but you guys know how gentle I am. So needless to say, what we gotta do now is bolt it up. And I am probably not gonna shear these off just yet until I see if this thing runs and all. We might have to do programming too. We might only be fixing half the trouble. So if I don't get a blinking light or something, and I've got the old module, I'm keeping it right here so I can, I might have to do a module swap with my scan tool. I think it might allow for that and it won't need full programming, but I'm not positive. Because Farfignugan and stuff. So I'll wait to shear these off, but I'll snug it up.
Be programmed?
I think it just gets like an initialized type of thing, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
Farfignugan, you know, they go out of their way to make things interesting. I'm not going to shear them off yet just in case, but let's just plug it in and see what happens. Oh. Ignition's on. Wipers are on. Stop it, wipers. All right, let's get the scanner. I got my ignition power. That's progress. So what this means is our lock module dealio, I haven't bolted this back together yet because I have to turn the steering wheel and get to these screws and stuff. But this fixed our issue, but now the immobilizer has to be all set up. So I'm hoping I can transfer data from that one and that one into that one, or with that one, you know what I mean. 2014 Volkswagen Jetta. One of the interesting things about this car is we also noticed a little bit of oil on the ground underneath it. So once we get it running, I'm going to see if maybe, I'm hoping it's just a drain plug or something, which I want to say I remember putting a gasket on. System list, smart scan. I'm going to look and see if there's an immobilizer or lock column, a column lock module replacement. And it'll tell you, plug the old one in, upload data, plug the new one in, download data. That's what we're hoping. And that'll do my immobilizer. If not, we'll have to call a locksmith. So we will see what happens. This is going to take a second. Another thing I'm going to do is grab the battery charger, because I don't want the battery to go dead again. I don't think it had anything to do with it now in hindsight. All the Volkswagen mechanics that we talked to said, oh yeah, I change those things all the time. Volkswagen said they keep six in stock, so in any event, I feel pretty good about that. Let's get the charger on it so it doesn't go dead again, just in case. Head on into the steering lock module and touch backup flash data. Oh, see, that's, it's not liking this one. That's the old one plugged in to see if it would do it. Please perform the function of decrypt dump data. Obtained from dump data, decode dump data. If you have the correct Volkswagen scan tool, it's probably easier, but I was hoping this scanner would do it. Failed communication with chip. Yeah. Check whether the connection diagram is correct. A lot of times you have to have a separate module between your scanner and the car. It's like an anti-theft module Volkswagen wants you to use. Let's do a little more research. All right. I reset the oil change reminder while I'm in here, because now everything powers up, it's all working correctly. We just got to get the immobilizer learned. I'm going to leave this apart in case it matters. It's just a few screws to put the covers back on. Two in the front, one from underneath. And they're going to try to get with a locksmith or someone, see if someone will do it. Might not be easy to find someone that will do it, because it wants you to have a special tool. I'll show you. If you go in here, anti-theft. Now, what's cool about these is generation 4 and above immobilizer systems, what it says right here. Now, anti-theft key matching, or I can do immobilizer module. I didn't replace the immobilizer module. I replaced the steering lock module. I'm not sure if it's the same thing. I don't think it is. Anti-theft key matching. Now, if I can go all keys are lost. Now, no matter what way I do it, this is the screen you get next. It wants you to have another special device besides your scanner, hooked to the car. Please simultaneously connect the diagnostic connector and anti-theft programmer, which is a Volkswagen thing. So I basically don't have that equipment, so it's going to be more cost effective to just pay a locksmith or someone who can do it. The problem is I'm not even sure if the locksmith's going to be too happy about it, so we'll see. Don't worry, baby, it's going to be okay. At least now that the column lock module isn't keeping the ignition from going on, I can put it in neutral, I can roll it forward, we can look and see what this oil leak might be. And they're calling a locksmith as we speak, just try to see something, if something can be done with it. And we'll come back. We wilding out. I got her up in the air, as you can see. The oil pan's leaking. My drain plug, see that? New gasket, perfect. Oil pan, not perfect. So, I tried the bolts, they're all tight. So I don't know if maybe the salvage yard took the pan off for some reason and put it back on without cleaning it and putting new silicone on. I don't know, totally speculation at this point, but one thing I do know, it's leaking. So not a lot I can do other than try to make it not leak, because we can't send this engine job down the road leaking, right? So I'm gonna clean it up a little bit. I guess we'll take it apart, waiting on a locksmith. I'm gonna check with them and see if the locksmith's on the way now, because getting it running is the priority. Doing this pan gasket will probably only take 45 minutes or so. I know some of the Volkswagen experts probably do it in -3 minutes or something, but all right, let me ask them if they want me to do this now or when this locksmith dude's gonna show. Sheriff's awful upset.
We just try to get looked that way like crazy yesterday after work.
Dude, I'm in my videos, I filmed it every time I got the camera on, they go by. And it's like 6 times every video some days. Well, that doesn't make sense. 6 times every video sometimes. It's very often, that's what I'm trying to say.
It happens a lot.
It's too much. Too many sirens, that's what I'm saying. I'm trying to save this oil since it's got no miles on it. 11 bucks is 11 bucks, you know what I'm saying? My goodness, this is by far the worst engine job I've ever done in 42 years, I think. 1982. Yeah, 42 years I've been doing this. Worst engine job ever. Hopefully it's not cracked or something weird like that. I don't think so, though. I'm gonna try to save all this oil. Once this drains, I'll pop that electrical connector off. That's just a level, I believe, level sensor. I'll pop the electrical connector, take all these torques out of here. We'll see what's going on. I wouldn't be surprised if they removed the pan and put it back in, but the bolts are tight. It's just got me baffled, like most things on this whole entire car from start to finish. I did put the cap back on the old oil container, so we don't have to worry about dust getting in there and stuff. Although it's not the end of the world, you just want to try to minimize it. The filter will catch it, but why make the filter catch it if you can avoid it? That's what I'm trying to say. Today's the last day of the month. Not terribly confident it's going today. Be nice if it goes by tomorrow for my paycheck at least. Uh-oh. Come on, man. It's killing me, bro. Some of them are 75 foot-pounds, some of them are three, I don't know.
Oh, I know what you want. You want to get my knuckles on that. I got you.
I don't think so.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, the bolt's gonna strip, it's so tight. Two of the bolts won't come out. They stripped, so. Just a little extra fun, that's all. They don't even charge me any extra for this. All right, now I need some way to split that thing. And what I prefer to use, they sell special tools, but a gasket scraper usually works if you can get to it this way. Yeah, see, it's already kind of loose over here. Someone broke the seal on the oil pan. Although it is kind of snugged up there still. Maybe the silicone just decided to start leaking. It usually doesn't do that, but anything's possible. Oh, yeah. This was popped off and put back on. That's what it was. Much like the rest of the engine, someone's been messing with it. If the salvage yard requires the stuff to be taken off, leave all the bolts out, or only put a few of them in and put it in a Ziploc bag so someone can look. Just like with the water pump debacle, they loosened the bolts. I don't know if it was a lead cooling out or what. And they didn't tighten them back up, so I have to wonder if there's a gasket and take it all apart. On this car, it's like 4 hours labor. So now I'm doing more stuff because of the stupid junkyard. I think that's one thing people don't realize too is if I put a new engine out of a crate in this, it would have been way quicker. Because I wouldn't have had to take the lines off of two blocks, two turbos, all that stuff I had to deal with, which makes it take longer. I'm gonna clean this up and we'll silicone it back together. And for anyone new here, who might be wondering, I will not be using a Scotch-Lock pad. Most of you probably already know that. Scotch-Lock pads are for cleaning brake hubs and cast iron blocks. Nothing else. For removing rust and things like that from a caliper pad track. Bring in the cleanup crew. I'm wanting this thing to be hermetically sealed when I'm done. We'll see what happens. Me and this car, we're not getting along. I don't know if you can tell. I didn't think I'd gonna be rebuilding the salvage engine, but that's all right. But you know what? The hits keep coming. This, the float's not supposed to detach, so I'm gonna JB weld your own there. If it doesn't work, it's three bolts to pull it out of the bottom of the pan. I had just about enough, guys. So I don't know whose clipboard this is, but they left it on my workbench, so it's fair game, right? It'll never be the same again, but I'll clean it a little. Now this goes in this gap here. I cleaned it up with brake clean and all the necessary stuff you're supposed to do when you're fixing an oil level float. Farfig Nugan. JB Weld's all set up, kind of. Good enough for what we're doing. I'm guessing it's not gonna work when we get done. I'm about to change it out, but that's all right. Right now, it's going back together. In case the locksmith gets here and wants to start it up and stuff.
I don't want chunks of this silicone getting in my mix. Today's friendly co-worker tip. Don't use rags to wipe silicone up and then stick them in the rag bucket to go back to the uniform guy. Because then the rags come back to you with silicone all over them. Just saying. Gonna be a nice guy. Do one to others before they do you. I mean, you'd have them do one to you, that's it. Feeling about how this is gonna go. All right, be right back. You know, you open these with the tip of the cap, right? Most people know, but just in case. I seen a guy the other day put the silicone on, RTV, whatever you want to call it, and then he smeared it around with his finger. Don't do that. It's meant to have a bead of silicone, then it squishes between the two panel pieces when you push it together, bolt it together. You ever watch the robots build engines? Pretty amazing to watch. They put a perfect bead with a robot arm and push the panel together. No one smears it with their finger, just saying. Make sure no drips around my surface. Try not to break the seal and let it down now.
Hey Kyle.
Supposed to say it, hey Kyle. He hears that way too much. Poor guy. We got quite a few bolts to put in here. Let's get to it, speed things up a little bit. What do you say?
Go buy a hand pump, you freaking old timer. Go ahead.
What does he want? Let that set up a little bit. I could throw some oil in it at least. Put my under pan bag on there. Take a look at my silicone job. That's what I'm talking about. That's how it's supposed to look, boys and girls. I'm not trying to brag. It might even leak when we're done. I don't know. But it came out good. Looks good to me. I'm happy with it. Got a little schmear right here, but that's all right. Do not wipe this. You might be tempted to, but don't do that. If you're building some kind of show car thing, you can let it cure and then cut it off with a razor blade or something, but this... there's no need for any of that. So anyway, let's set up, put a little oil in it. Once the silicone skims over, it takes about 20 minutes or so, maybe 30. No rush. This car's been here for a month, so it's no big deal. We got time. Got the old trickle charger on there. Make sure this thing doesn't go dead again, just so I feel better about it. I don't think the battery going dead over the weekend caused the problem. I think the problem caused the battery to go dead or something, maybe, but. Oh, geez, everyone all right out there? Someone's being choked to death? Let's go ahead and put the dinosaur blood in this thing so I don't have to worry about that. I found a couple of bolts for the oil pan in the old motor. I hadn't put it outside yet, sitting over there at the end of the bay. Just in case for that reason. Till this car's done and going, I'm not going to get rid of that motor. Once the car is gone, the motor will go in a scrap pile. with the others. We got a bunch of them out there. Now this is not fresh, golden, delicious dinosaur blood. This has got about 20 minutes worth of runtime on it. Locksmith's coming out between 12 and 2 tomorrow. So we may have this thing running finally. Oh, the valve cover design. I showed you the valve cover last time. It's got a big baffle right in the opening because Volkswagen. You can see the oil's still sweet. Alright guys, we're winding a day down. There's nothing else gonna happen today. End of the month. Cars are being pulled around to be picked up, but there's no new work coming in. So we'll pick up where we left off tomorrow. Hopefully the locksmith will get here early enough to get this thing done and running tomorrow. I'm not sure if we'll get to deliver it, but if it's done, I get paid. That's what helps me. But it's the first day of the month, so no one's really gonna be as concerned anymore. But they got the customer really wants it back. I'll kick this out. They haven't had the car for 2 years. They need to use it. They're paying on it. Alright, so we're winding this video down. Thanks for watching. I enjoyed your company. Like I've told you before, man, when I'm having these tough days, I try to hold back on it a little bit, let you see that I'm pretty frustrated, but not stress you out. That's not the point. I don't want to do that. So let me know what you thought. Also, torque the like button before you leave, or subscribe if you haven't yet and you're new. I appreciate all you watching, and I hope I see you in the next video, because you're awesome.